from Synergetics Tech Private Limited, and I welcome you all to our today's free live workshop on developing cloud-native application with Python. I kindly request you all to be ready with your laptop as it's going to be a full-day hands-on training. We have already provided you with the software requirements. This workshop is taken by ATC and sponsored by Microsoft Azure and Synergetics. I would also like to inform you all that this is our last workshop on our live series, Azure Python. A brief about our ATC community. It is for all, but we majorly focus on people who are related and interested in Azure-related technology. People interested could join the meetup groups, visit our website, follow ETC and ATC for more details. ATC is basically for people who live in Pune. ETC is for others who are interested to join in. Once you follow our community, you would automatically get the update on our events, meetups, and webinars. Talking about our code of conduct, I request you all, please do not take any screenshots of the meetings and the presentation that will be shared by our speaker today. Also, please do not record our live meeting. Today's agenda of our workshop is to develop cloud native application using Python. The agenda and the topics that we are focusing on is storage account for static files, Azure database for PostgreSQL, deploying apps for app services, monitoring with application insight, dockerizing Python Django application, configuring Django for deployment, enabling CI/CD for Azure DevOps. I'm pleased to introduce you all to our today's speaker, Mr. Sonu Satyadas. Mr. Satyadas started his career as a technical trainer for HCL. He later became the senior corporate trainer at Global Talent Track for the duration of 3 years. Since then, we are lucky to have him as a part of Synergetic IT Services. With an experience of more than 12 years, he is now a technology expert in Azure, .NET Core, Docker, microservices, and JavaScript frameworks. He is currently working as a practice head for open source technologies, carrying a good experience in designing solutions in Azure PaaS and NaaS services. He also provides training in various other technologies, such as Python, .NET Core, HTML5, Angular, React with Redux, Backbone JS, Azure, Cognitive Services, Boat Framework, and Office 365. He has trained many employees from big Fortune companies like Microsoft, L&T, Capgemini, Syntel, not only in India, but from the US, the UK, Sri Lanka, and other countries as well. He is a tech speaker and has conducted worldwide sessions and has published a lot of tech blogs, for which you can visit our website. Mr. Satyadas would be taking the session today on cloud native application using Python. He would be covering a wide range of topics in our today's session. He indeed is a very insightful person, and I'm pretty sure that we would get to learn a lot from him and also get our doubts clarified regarding Python. Due to the unfortunate COVID situation, we have come up with the initiative of live workshop Azure Python. We have already completed 2 webinars and 1 workshop. The recordings for the webinar are available on our YouTube channel. The link would be provided on our chat box. Also, the second workshop is held today. About the recordings regarding the workshop, we'll get back to you soon on that. The second initiative taken by us is live API on Azure meetup. These are the 4 meetings that have already been done, and the recordings are again available on our YouTube channel. Please do subscribe. I would request you to all kindly mute your mics. Thank you. We are also done with the certificate related webinar series. It includes DP200, DP201, DP100 certificate webinar, which is available on our YouTube channel. The third initiative taken by us is the live virtual training, in which we provide you a long list of courses. We also provide you with live training plus MOC plus exam voucher only for 17,500. On that, we have come up with a masterclass on AZ900 Azure Fundamental. This class will be taken on 4th July 2020 from 9:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. It is only for 1,500. So people who are interested, please do let us know. For more details, you can contact Ms. Shilpa Awad. The last and the final thing before we start and commence our workshop is, we will have our lunch break at 1 p.m. for a duration of 1 hour. I request you all to be back by 2 p.m. Also, I would request you all to not leave the meeting because it might be difficult for you to get in back. So kindly stay tuned even during your lunch break. Third thing, we will be taking the attendance thrice during our workshop today, one at the very beginning, one immediately after the lunch break, and one at the end of our workshop. In order to receive your participation certificate, I hope that you will have to maintain your attendance all the three times. Also, after the workshop, we will be floating a feedback form. In order to get the participation certificates, we request you to please fill up the feedback form as soon as possible. Now, the session would be taken up by Mr. Sonu Satyadas. Thank you.
Hello. Hello, everyone. This is Sonu Satyadas. Thanks, Ritika, for giving a good introduction. So let me share my screen. I hope it's now visible to everyone.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So as you've seen in the introduction, that today we are talking about the cloud native apps development using Python. So in this session, we will be covering some of the Azure services that we can use in our Python app development. So the requirements, this will be a complete hands-on based test session. So the requirements has been already shared with the team, and I hope it must have been circulated to you. So I request all of you to have a Azure subscription and the Azure CLI installed in your machines, because this hands-on session, we will be doing the service creations and other things using the Azure CLI. So we expect you people have a basic understanding about the cloud services to go ahead, because this is not a deep dive session on the cloud services. We will be covering only a few Azure services that is used within our Python application. So as she mentioned, I am working as a practice head for open source and .NET. So I have 12 years of industry experience in development and training. And I'm a Microsoft certified trainer in the cloud platform. So in this session, we will be primarily covering the Azure services like storage account. So we will be using the storage account for our Python application to manage the static files and the media files. So how this can be configured in our application, in our Python Django application, I will be demonstrating during the session. And for the database storage, we will be using the open source database that is PostgreSQL, which is available as a PaaS service in the Azure platform. And then we will be deploying our applications into app services. I will be demonstrating how to deploy the application directly from the VS Code and how to enable the deployment using the CI/CD using GitHub. And also I will demonstrate how to deploy the application using Docker container through the ACR with Azure DevOps pipelines. Then for monitoring, we will be enabling the application insights, which is the monitoring platform for the web applications. And we'll see how to dockerize a Python Django application and how we can push the Docker images to the container registry. And then we will look at some of the configurations that is required for Django application. If you are planning to deploy your Django application, what is required for the production environment, how to configure your application for the production environment, that we will be looking. And finally, we will go with the Azure DevOps pipelines for continuous integration and deployment. So this is the agenda for this session. So let's get started. So I hope all of you have a basic understanding about the Microsoft Azure Cloud Platform. So if anybody is not well aware about the Azure and the Cloud Platform, for them, I'm just giving a brief idea. Microsoft Azure is a cloud service or cloud platform provided by Microsoft for deploying the applications, for storing the data, and for connecting to various services and networks. So it offers various services like compute, storage, and networking services with a wide range of services that you can see in each category. For deploying your applications, we can make use of the IaaS services like virtual machines or virtual machine scale sets, or you can go ahead with the PaaS services like app service, web apps, containerized application deployment using Kubernetes, ACI, and even microservices deployment using the service fabric, the serverless computing platform like Logic Apps for workflow creations, Azure Functions for serverless functions. And it is also provides different storage options for various types of data storage. If you are going to store unstructured data like images, audio files, video files, and any other type of files that you want to place or that you want to use in our applications, you can use the unstructured data storage like a storage account, means storage account blocks and file shares. You can go ahead with the structured data storage like a relational databases. The Azure provides a wide range of services for relational databases, including SQL database, SQL managed instance, SQL virtual machines. Then you can use the Azure database for MySQL, Azure database for PostgreSQL, Azure database for MariaDB. And if you are looking for some NoSQL type of data storage, then you have CosmosDB that can support a variety of NoSQL data formats like MongoDB, Core SQL, that is DocumentDB, Table APIs, Cassandra, and the Gremlin APIs. A part of this storage services and database services, we have networking services like virtual network, load balancers, application gateway, traffic manager, network watcher service, firewall. So like this, many services are available in the Azure platform. And these are some of the common core services that I have explained. And there are hundreds of services available in the Azure platform. But in this session, we will be focusing only the services that is required for our application deployment. So if we are planning to create a Python application, so here Python is providing a various set of frameworks for developing the web application and the AI application. But here we are considering the web application development. And also we are considering the Django as the framework for developing the web application. I have taken a simple Python application to demonstrate the use of this Azure services. So we will be looking how to store the static files and the media files that we are using in our application using the storage account, how to use the PostgreSQL database for our backend database in our application, how to monitor the application using Application Insights, how to containerize the application using Docker, and how to make it available to the applications, means deployment services, using the ACR, that is Azure Container Registry. And we will also see the web apps for deploying the application. And we will also see the Azure DevOps integration for the Python application. So we will start with our first service, that is Azure Storage Account. So as the name indicates, this is a storage service. This is one of the four storage services that Azure offers, where we can store different types of data or different types of information inside the storage account. The Azure Storage Account as a storage service offers four types of storage services. One is Azure Blobs, as now called as container services, not the Docker container. This is the Blob container service. The Azure Files, which is a mountable file share. Azure Tables for key value pair, semi-structured data storage, and the Azure Queues. If we are enabling our applications to communicate over a queue, then we can use the Azure Queues, that is an HTTP-based queue that can be used to integrate different applications. So in this blob service, this is the first service that we see in the storage account. The blob service is providing a massive storage option, or it will allow you to store up to 500 terabytes of data into the storage account. You can store all kinds of files, including your image files, audio files, video files, text files, CSS or JavaScript files, or maybe if you have some archives that you can store, anything can be uploaded into the blob, where you will where you can go and access those files over an HTTP URL. So you can use an HTTP URL for accessing those files. And it provides a various security options for protecting the files from the unauthorized access. In the coming slides, we'll be seeing that. And the Azure Files is another service that we can see in the Azure Storage Account, where you can create the mountable file share that can be used as an extended storage for your virtual machines or desktops. If you want to create a file share in the Azure platform, you can go and use the Azure File service, create a file share with 100 GB or 50 GB or 1 terabyte, whatever size you want, and you can map that as a network drive into your virtual machine or desktop machine. Because it is using the SMB 3.0 protocol, it can be mapped as a network file share. And later you will be able to use it like a normal disk drive in your machine. You don't need to use any kind of third-party application or interface to upload and download the files into the file share. how you are uploading the files or how you are copying the files into the C drive or D drive or E drive of your machine. The similar way you will be able to upload and download the files into the file shares, because it appear as a network drive in your machine. You can map the Azure file shares as a network drive in your Windows machines, Linux machines, and as well as Mac machines. The Azure table is the third service that is storing the data in the form of key value pairs. We call it as entities. These entities can have 256 keys and values inside it. Out of that, the partition key and the row key and a timestamp value are fixed keys. So that the partition key is used for distributing the data across the storage account. And the row key is used to identify the unique entities from the partition. Since it is using the Azure storage account, you can store up to 500 terabytes of storage space, because each storage account in Azure provides 500 terabytes of storage. When it comes to Azure queues, the queues, as we know, it is used for a publish-subscribe pattern, where one application can publish the messages or send the messages to the queue, and one or more applications can consume messages from the other end. So they can subscribe to the messages on the queue, and they will be able to consume those messages. These messages are sent as simple text files of 64 KB each. That means one message size is maximum 64 KB. Since this queue is not a persistent storage, it can store the data or store the messages for a maximum period of 7 days. And it is using an HTTP interface, like HTTP endpoint, for sending and receiving the messages, because this is not the traditional AMQP protocol queues, because this is the HTTP based queue service. If you are looking for the AMQP, means Advanced Messaging Queuing Protocol based messaging services, you can use the service bus service, because the service bus is another service that can be used for queues and topics. But the Azure queues, that is storage queues, is part of storage account, which provides simple queue-based application integration. Out of these four services, we will be focusing on the blob storage only, because in our Python application, we will be focusing the blob service to store the static files and media files. So the blob service in storage account help you to store the unstructured data in the cloud platform. You can set the access tier for your blob files, like if it is a frequently accessed file, you can set it as a hot tier. If it is an infrequently accessed file, you can set it as cool tier, which reduce the cost of read and write operations. You can also configure it for archival storages, which is for rarely accessed data. You can configure the lifecycle of the blob files to set the access tier, like whether the file need to go into a cool tier or it need to go into the archival storage. So you can set a policy for managing the life cycle of your blob files. That is possible in the blob storage. The blob storage provides, or the storage account provides two type of storage mechanisms, like means the backend storage can be a normal magnetic disk storage type, which we call as standard storage. But if you are expecting high IOPS for your read-write operations, you can choose the SSD-based storage accounts. We call it as premium storages. So for high IOPS data read-write operations, we use premium storage for our storage account. And for normal data access, we can use the standard storage, which uses the magnetic disk. Inside the blob storage, we will be creating containers. Don't confuse with the name container, because you may be familiar with the Docker container name, but the Docker container is different. Here we call it as blob container. It's just a folder kind of thing. It's not exactly a folder. It just, you can say, it's a box. As the name indicates, it's a container, which can be used for containing the files and the folders. So a container is a box or a placeholder where you can put all your files and the directories. It is possible to configure different access policies for your blob containers for securing the file access. Suppose if you want to anonymously access, you can set some access control. And if you want to restrict the anonymous access, we can set some other access control. So we'll discuss that in the coming slide. So we will be using this blob storage primarily for serving the images or documents directly from our browser, because when we load the web application in our browser, we can load the images and the other static files. Suppose if your application is using CSS files or JavaScript files or some images or any other kind of documents, instead of storing all the files into the web server or the location where you are deploying your application, you can use a reliable storage for keeping the static files or this media files. So you can use the blob storage as a static file storage in your application. So we will see how this can be configured in our Python Django application for keeping those static files and media files in the blob storage. So you can also use this blob storage for distributed access, since you can upload the files into the containers and that files are accessible over an HTTP URL. So you can access those files from anywhere in the world. So you can provide access to any user from any location, because the files are stored in the cloud storage and that is accessible using the HTTP URL. It can also be used for streaming the video and audio files. You can store the backup and backup data that can be used for disaster recovery and high availability. Suppose if you are using on-premise database or a virtual machine, so the backup of this virtual machines and the databases you can store inside the blob storage. So you can use it as a DR solution. You can store the high volume of data for analysis purpose. Suppose if you are using some analysis services where you need to upload a large set of files, maybe if you are using a cognitive service which requires a large set of files, maybe image files or audio files or any other type of input files, you can use the blob service as a storage for such services. And for any other analysis services, you can use the blob as a input source. The blob container, as I mentioned in the previous slide, we will be creating a container inside the blob service to put the files and folders. You can create multiple files and multiple containers within the blob service, and you can set different access permissions. So primarily we are setting the access permissions like a private, blob, and the container access. So if you are uploading the files that need to be accessible from any location over an HTTP endpoint or HTTP URL without any restriction, that means without any authentication, you want to access those files. For example, in our web applications, I want to access the logo. The logo is located, or the logo is stored inside the blob storage. And if I want to access that logo image from my blob storage, I have to set its access permission as anonymous access. That means you can set either it as blob access, because blob access permission is giving anonymous access to the files that is stored inside the blob container. You can also set the container level access for anonymous access, that is also providing anonymous access to those files. But the difference in blob access and the container access is, if you are setting the container access, it will provide a list operation also. That means you are able to enumerate the list of files which is stored inside the blob container. Suppose if you have hundreds of files, you can enumerate the list of files. You can, using a, maybe if you are using a program like Python or C sharp or Java, you can enumerate the list of files, and using a for loop, you can print all the files located inside the container, because it provides list permission. But the blob access does not provide the list permission. It allows you to access the file individually using that file URL. But listing the files within the container is not allowed. But if you are storing the files that contain some sensitive data or that confidential information, you can keep the files inside the container and set the container access permission as private, which means anonymous access is not allowed for your files. So if you are trying to access the files using the HTTP URL, it will give you an error, because directly using the HTTP URL, you cannot access the files that is protected with a private access level. To access such private access files or private files, you need to provide certain credentials along with the URL. We can call it as access tokens. So we can generate shared access signature tokens, means SAS tokens, and attach it to the URL, and that defines the permission of the blob. So you will be able to access the private files or the files that is stored with the private access level. But in our web applications, we will be using the static files anonymously, or we need to access those files anonymously. So we can set our container permission as blob or container. As I mentioned in the previous slide, if you are setting the files or sorry, if you are setting the container's access level as private, you will not be able to access the files directly using the URL. You need to provide certain credentials along with the URL. And that credential we call as SAS tokens, which is shared access signature. The Azure portal is providing options for generating the SAS tokens. You can also generate shared access policies, which can be stored inside the blob container itself, because the SAS tokens, once it is generated, they will not be stored inside the Azure account. So if you want to invalidate the already issued token, the only way to invalidate it is regenerate the access token, means access key. So which key is used for signing the token, you have to change this key. So there is an option for regenerating the signing key. So that signing key we can regenerate to invalidate the already issued token. But regenerating the key will be always difficult. So it is a good practice to use stored access policies, where you can create certain stored access policy credentials and generate the SAS tokens based on the stored access policy. So the benefit is, in case if you wish to invalidate a particular token which is already issued, you don't need to go and regenerate the sign-in key. So the sign-in key, if you regenerate, maybe other users or other applications will be affected, because they may be also using the same sign-in key. So it is better to go and delete or modify the stored access policy, which is created as part of, or which is created for generating the SAS token. So in this one, you need to understand what is a SAS token, which is containing certain credentials or privileges and permissions that can be used to access the files and folders protected with the private access level. You can create a storage account either directly using the Azure portal. You can also use the Azure PowerShell. You can also use the Azure CLI, or you can also use some programming languages or the ARM template. But here, for the demo purpose, we will be using the Azure CLI, because this is a cross-platform command line interface. Even now, the PowerShell is also available in Linux and Mac. PowerShell Core is available, but the Azure CLI is the most widely used cross-platform command line interface. That's the reason we have used, or we have selected CLI as the way of creating resources within your Azure account. If you wish to create a storage account, as I mentioned, you have to create a storage account to create a container and upload a blob, right? Because the blob service is part of your storage account service. So to create a storage account, first you need to log into the Azure portal or Azure account. For that, you can use the AZ login command. And then you can use the AZ storage account create command and provide the parameters like storage account name. The storage account name, which is passed through the parameter name minus N. So the minus N indicates the name of the storage account. And the name should be globally unique, because the name will be part of a URL. And that URL is used to access those files. So obviously, the storage account name that you are providing must be globally unique one. And you can also specify a resource group. If you are familiar with the Azure concept, you can understand a resource group is a mandatory resource for grouping your Azure services, means any service instance that you create, whether it is a storage account or a VM or a web app or anything. When you create, you have to select a resource group. A resource group is just to logically group all the resources inside your Azure account. So you can specify the name of the resource group using the minus G parameter. And you can also specify the location, means in which data center or in which region you want to create the storage account. The storage account location you can pass using the minus L parameter. And the SKU value is representing what is the replication mode, that is the redundancy mode as well as the storage type, whether it is a standard storage or a premium storage. As I mentioned, if you are planning to use the magnetic disk storage, then you can use the standard. If you are looking for SSD based storage, you can go for premium. And you can also specify the replication option, whether it can be LRS, ZRS, GRS, RAGRS, GZRS. There are many replication options available. Since we are not going into the details of those features, we are just focusing only the blob service. So I'm not explaining about the replication options. So the storage type and the replication can be specified in the SKU value. And the access tier is specifying the default access tier of your blob files, like whether it is a frequently accessed file, then you can set it as hot, or it's a infrequently accessed file, then you can set it as cool. It is possible that you can upload the blobs using the CLI. You can specify the file path using the minus F parameter. Minus C is used for container name, into which container you are going to upload the files. And the minus N is used for the blob name. So we can go and try out a simple storage account creation. So how the storage account can be created, how the blob container can be created, and how to upload certain files. Because from our Python application, we are going to upload the files into the storage account blob. The static files of your Python application, we are going to put into a blob container. So let's go and do a simple demo, how the storage account can be created and how to create the blob containers and upload the file. Let's go to the Azure portal. If you have any questions, you can post your questions in the chat window. Okay, is Azure free to use? So Azure subscription you can get for 1 month free subscription. You can go to the Azure free trial page, means in the Azure documentation page itself, you will see the link for creating the free account. Using your credit card or debit card, you can register for 1 month free trial. You will be getting $200 credit, and nothing will be deducted from your credit card or debit card. It will be just used for the verification purpose. Okay, so, or you can use the pay as you go option, but what is the consumption, means what are the services you are using, those services charges will be deducted from your account, means from your credit card or debit card, whatever you have used, if you are going with a pay as you go model. So, but for the study purpose, you can, or for the testing purposes, you can go and create a free trial that provides $200 credit for 1 month with all the service features. Yes, Partha Sarathy, right? Yeah. You can do the demo along with me because there will be no separate hands-on session. So when I do the demo, you can also start doing the demo. The required things for doing the demo, first, you must have an Azure subscription. Second, you need an Azure CLI installed in your machine, or you can use the Azure Cloud Shell to create and manage the services. So for this demo, it requires these two things. Let's go to the Azure portal. You can navigate to the portal.azure.com. Let me go to portal.azure.com. We'll be sharing that URL in the chat window. Whenever you start doing the demo, it's better to create a new resource group. Because if you are using your existing subscriptions, we can go and create a new resource group, because I don't want to put all the resources in your existing resource group. So for this session, what are the hands-ons we are doing? Let's put them into the resource group. So let me go to the resource groups. So I already have a set of resource groups created. Let me go and add a new resource group. If you are not familiar with the Azure account, you can see here, if you click on the left side top menu, it's the three lines, you will see the options here where you can see the resource group. Click on this resource group. And if there is a resource group exist, you will see that resource group here. And let's go and create a new resource group here. Give a name for your resource group. Let's name it as 5-day group. So this is the resource group, or maybe 5-day workshop group. So I can give the name as 5-day workshop group. And the location of my resource group is in East US. I can do the same thing using the command also. If you are planning to do it using the command, then open your command prompt. If Linux or Mac users, then you can, they can open their bash shell or the terminal. And they can first try the command that is az login. So if you want to log into your Azure account, use the command az login. That will be prompting for the username and password. So it will open the Azure login page, means login page for Microsoft. You can enter your Azure account credentials there, username and password. Once you have done with the login, then you can create a new resource group using the az group create minus n, then the name of the group, suppose my 5-day group. Can be a name I have already created, so I'm not going to create again. Minus L for the location, like East US. So you can use this commands to log in and create the resource group. So we will be using the same resource group for this complete session. So as you can see here, the new resource group is created. Right? There is no resources inside this resource group. Now we can go and create a new storage account. So to create a storage account, first I will show how to create it using the Azure portal. As you can see, we can go to the create a resource option. Let's do that. Here I can go and search for the storage service. Under the storage service, I can see the storage account. This is the storage account. So I'm going with the resource group which I have created just now, that is 5-day workshop group. Storage account name, that should be a unique name. So I am giving 5-day storage account. Let me check the availability. This is available. If you are doing, please provide a different name for your storage account. Do not give the same name. Location of my storage account is same, East US. Performance, I can say it is standard or premium. That means whether you want magnetic disk or premium disk, SSD disk. And then storage V2, that is the account kind. The replication, I can just make it as locally redundant. And the default access tier, make it hot. And then you can review and create. I'm not going with the other configurations, just review and create. So these are the configurations that we are providing for our storage account. Okay. So for storage account, if you are doing it, let me first continue this creation. If you are on the home page, you can click on this three lines, and you can choose this create a resource, or you can click on this plus create a resource. You click here, you can search here. If you are not aware where is the storage account, actually it comes under the storage service category. This is the one. You can click on the storage and then storage account, this one. But if you are not familiar with this, then just search for storage account. When you search the storage account, you will see this option here. Click on create and you will see this options. So if you are planning to create it using the command, then there is an option. You can use the terminal or the cloud shell. Cloud shell means you can go to the Azure portal itself, where you will see the cloud shell. So the cloud shell will give you the command prompt here itself if you have not installed the Azure CLI in your machine. So you can either create it using the Azure portal or using the command prompt. No need to create two times, but I'm showing both the options. So I'm just going to use Visual Studio Code to keep all the commands that I'm going to fire here to the Azure For getting the IntelliSense support, I have installed the extension inside my VS Code, that is the Azure CLI Tools. The Azure CLI Tools is an extension that provides IntelliSense support. So AZ login is used for login to Azure. And create a resource group, AZ group create. For creating a storage account, I can use the AZ storage account create minus N, and the name of the storage account, I can say 5-day workshop storage minus G, then the resource group. As if you are using this as the resource group name, then you can use this minus L for location. East US. Access tier, I can say hot. Then I can also say kind storage V2. Standard LRS. So these are the parameters that I'm going to use in my storage account. So if you look at this, as you can see, this contains the name of the storage account, resource group name, location, access tier hot, account kind storage V2, and the SKU as standard LRS. So you can put this everything in one line when you execute from the cloud shell. Just copy this. I'm just giving this in the chat window. SKU is representing the replication and the performance. Like if you are using magnetic disk, then it is representing standard. If it is SSD, then it is premium. And the kind of replication option means whether it is replicated. For the high availability, you can replicate the data within a single data center or across multiple data centers. So what kind of replication option you have used, that is LRS, GRS, RAGRS options mentioned. So SKU is typically mentioning the performance, that is standard or premium, underscore the replication option. LRS means locally redundant storage. So you can execute this command from the Azure Cloud Shell. As you can see, when you go to the Cloud Shell, you will be getting the cloud here, or you can switch to PowerShell. But since we are executing the CLI, so you have to go to the bash in the Cloud Shell and execute it here. So the command is already shared in the chat window. So all these commands. So when you execute the CLI commands from the Cloud Shell, there is no need to log in. Do not try the login command from the Cloud Shell because you have not required in Cloud Shell. Because in Cloud Shell, you are already logged in, right? Because you are already inside the Azure. So there is no need to log in again. So I have just created one storage account. As you can see here, this is my storage account. Let's go into the storage account. So as you can see, this is my resource group. Inside the resource group, you can see the storage account. You can see the four types of services here, like a container, file share, tables, and queues. Are you done with the storage account? Guys, you have created the storage account. You can use either the CLI commands or you can use the Azure portal UI itself for creating this. Okay, fine. I will wait for a couple of minutes to complete the creation. Okay, so I hope the storage account must have created now, and you can see the containers option here in the overview section. If you go to the storage account, you will see the overview, and inside the overview you will see the basic informations of storage account and the container. Click on this container. As you can see, there is no containers created as of now. Okay, fine. So there is no containers created as of now. You can create your first container. Just click on this and name it as images. And why this public? Container data is okay. Let me, so you can see here, we can usually, when we create a container, we should get this drop down list enabled. I don't know why it is disabled now. So when I create this, you will see the container created. Right, so you can see here the images container, this option here. Let me check, I don't know why this is disabled. As you can see here, the images container is created. If you go inside the images container, there is an option for uploading these files. You can click and upload the files from your local machine. So, but whatever files you are uploading, suppose if I'm uploading this image, you can see I can upload one image inside this. This is my image container, which contains one file. Are you able to create the container? let me check any other container has some issue. Every container has some default. Okay, so inside this images container, I have this image. When I click on this image, you will see a URL. I told you the images will be accessible using a URL. So if you click on this URL, since you can copy this URL and open a new tab, a new browser tab, and put this, you can see this is the URL of your particular file. Since this is given as private access, when you try to access the file, it is showing an error. You can see public access not permitted. Okay. But look at this. I have some other storage account created here. This is one of my other storage account. If I go here, you can see there are many other containers created. If I go and create, here I will be getting an option for blob, container, and private. So if I go to any of this file, like this is an image, the URL I can copy, and let's put it, and I will be able to access this file. So I can access the files directly using the URL without any restriction. Right, so that because I have configured this, I have configured this container for access level as container. So container access level means anonymous access is allowed. So you will be able to anonymously access those files directly using the URL. Guys, please check whether you are able to access those files directly using the URL. Just go to the file, copy the URL like this. If you go inside the container, you will see the file. Click on the file, and here you can copy the URL. Just copy the URL and put it into the browser, and you will be able to access it. Please confirm whether you are able to access those files directly using the URL. Make sure the access level is set as container or blob. So if you go to the container, like here my container name is media. Inside this media, my access level, here you can change the access level. And if it is private, then you will not be able to access it. But if you are setting it as blob or container, you will be able to directly access it using URL. So public access not permitted. It may be the storage account creation time. The networking configuration is not done. Let me check once again. We have filled this part. And then the next one, public endpoint is done. Blob public access disabled here, that's why. While creating this blob, public access is by default disabled. So this is something new feature they have added. By default, it was public access was enabled. So let me go and check whether it can be modified in the properties or somewhere. Here, public access I have enabled under the configuration. Inside this configuration, let me check the public access enabled, and then let me try to change it. Okay, now you can see it is enabled. Yes, you can see it. So if you are creating a storage account, what you need to do, make sure that the public access for the blob is enabled. So if it is not configured at the time of creation, so after creation, you can come to the storage account, go to the configuration and enable the blob public access is enabled. And then save the changes, go back to the container and set its access level here. Okay, are you able to do it now? So we have created storage account and we are now able to upload the files and we are able to directly access those files using the URL. Okay. Now let us go and look the next service, that is PostgreSQL. We are using this service in our application as a database storage. So if you are working in the Python Django applications, you will be aware the Django is using SQLite as a database by default. But SQLite is just a database file, which is a portable database file primarily used in mobile applications and all. It is a lightweight, simple database file. So Django is using the SQLite as the database for by default. But when you move into the production, it is not recommended to use the SQLite. Instead of that, we can use any other databases, since it's an open source technology, it's better to go with some open source databases. It provides support for other databases as well, like SQL Server, but it is recommended to go with some open source databases like PostgreSQL or MySQL or MariaDB kind of thing. So here we are considering the PostgreSQL will be the better choice for our application's backend database. That's the reason we have taken Azure Database PostgreSQL as the service for our application. If you look at this in Azure platform, it supports various relational databases from the open source technologies. like we know that, yes, obviously SQL Server is available as a database storage. But if you consider the open source technology, since we are focusing on the open source technologies, we can go with some of the open source relational database technologies. Like we can go with Azure Database for PostgreSQL, or Azure Database for MySQL, or Azure Database for MariaDB, where you can deploy your application data. But it is also available, that is the ClearDB, which is a MySQL's ClearDB implementation, is also available, but that is from the Microsoft partner or ISV kind of things. So Microsoft is providing the MySQL, MariaDB, and PostgreSQL services. Since it is a PaaS service, what is PaaS service? Platform as a service. It provides some platform features like a community version, which is fully managed. It provides the latest versions of PostgreSQL. You can go and create any of the version which is available in the Azure. So there are multiple versions supported. So not the very latest version available in the Azure account. You can see one version below the latest version. You will see, suppose if the latest is 10.5, then you may be seeing 10.4 in your Azure. So Azure is always going one version below the actual latest version. So you can see the latest versions of those database services, whether it is MySQL, PostgreSQL, or MariaDB, whatever it is. Latest versions are available. And it is not your responsibility to go and upgrade the versions. Periodically, the Azure will automatically update the versions. So it is not the responsibility of the user to go and upgrade the database. That will automatically happen. And the second platform feature, since it is a PaaS service, it provides automatic scaling of your database and compute. So it can be scaled, means you can scale your database from a low capacity to a higher capacity. So if you are interested, you can start with a small scale database service. Okay, maybe it is starting with a general purpose 2 CPU with a 25 GB storage. And as the data increases, as the demand increases, you can add more compute power and the more storage power to your database. And it provides replicas automatically. So means Microsoft itself is maintaining multiple replicas. So it provides high availability for your database. High availability means, in case if the database is down, that means the primary copy is down, which the user is currently using, it will be regenerating the database automatically from the secondary copies, that is the replicas. So replicas will be automatically maintained by the Azure for high availability. Third, it is possible to connect from various languages. As you can see here, PHP, Drupal, Django, that is Python or WordPress or Java, from any language you can connect to your databases, because it provides the open database endpoint. The traditional native libraries available, or the ODBC connectivity is possible. Protect your database and improve the performance with the built-in intelligence. There is a monitoring service that you can use to monitor your database. It is also provides built-in intelligence to the database platform to detect the anomalies. So in case if there is some attacks or some security threat is there, then your monitoring service can intelligently detect it and report to you. Unparalleled security and reach. Yes, it is possible to replicate your database into multiple region. So wherever you want to replicate your database, you are able to replicate your database into one or more databases. And obviously, simple and flexible pricing. It is available with the different pricing tiers. You can select the best suitable pricing tier for your application. When we focus on the PostgreSQL database, this is a community-driven database. This focus on your applications by leaving the management and patching of infrastructure and the database to an enterprise-ready cloud service. So the benefit of using such PaaS service is you don't need to worry about the high availability, security, patching, updates of this database. Everything will be taken care of by the Azure platform. So if you are going with the MySQL or you are going with the PostgreSQL or you are using the MariaDB, your existing on-premise applications, you can easily migrate to the cloud. You don't need to make any single line of code change because the existing code you can use as it is. You just need to update the connection string. So while creating the cloud database, you will be getting a connection string to connect to that database. Just update that connection string inside your application code. Not even single line of code change you need to make to run this application on the cloud. Okay. Build on your teams with the platform that supports your application development needs and offers a fully integrated Azure experience. Automatic updates, automatic security fixes, and automatic new feature updates. When you go with the Azure PostgreSQL, it gives you the benefits like create the database within minutes with the high availability. If you are trying to create your own server, PostgreSQL server in on-premise data center in your organization's company network, you may need to install the server, configure the security, configure the high availability. Means you, for high availability, you may need to create multiple replicas, enable the backup. Okay, so most of the things you have to explicitly configure, but in cloud, you can do everything in just a minute. Scale on the fly with virtually no downtime. So it is possible to scale from a small instance to a large instance. For example, if you are using a 2 CPU, 25 GB storage or Postgre database, and later you identify that your application requires more, you can easily scale to a larger instance with virtually no downtime. Yes, there will be a downtime, but that will be a very, very minute downtime. Security out of the box to protect the data in rest and motion, because any Azure data stored in the Azure platform and the data which is in motion is always encrypted. Okay, so you can encrypt the data, means it is always encrypted and store the data inside the cloud. Automatic backups and point in time restore up to 35 days. You can restore the data if there is some unavailability of your application, or if some downtime happens, you will be able to recover that data or recover the database from the automatic backups, and that can restore the data for up to 35 days. Continue to use same tools, libraries, and drivers. Means if you migrate your application from on-premise to the cloud, to use the cloud database, you don't need to use any additional library or drivers. The whatever you use for the on-premise PostgreSQL, the same thing can be used in the cloud. Simple and inclusive pay-as-you-go pricing. So simple pricing model is available for PostgreSQL. So when you go with the PostgreSQL, the architecture is like this. Inside your Azure account, you have a subscription. Inside the subscription, you will be creating a resource group. Inside the resource group, you will be creating a PostgreSQL server. And inside the server, you can create one or more databases. So as a user, you will be directly creating a PostgreSQL managed server. Managed server means you don't need to go and install anything. You just need to tell, okay, this is the PostgreSQL instance I want to create. So it will create a server instance for you automatically, and you can connect to that service using your IDE tools, like PG admin kind of tools you can use to connect to that database. So the server, it is a logical with the provision, the compute and storage resources. When while creating, you need to specify what is the compute capacity and the storage capacity. It's created within the Azure subscription, provides a namespace for the database, because all the databases you will be connecting through the server that you have created. And it is acting as a container for the databases. It's the connection endpoint for the server, can create one to many user databases. So we can create one or more databases within the same server, pinned to a region. So the server will be created within one region, but if you want, you can replicate this into other region. Policy scope, example, firewall rules, recovery, monitoring, and management. You can configure firewall rules, recovery, and monitoring for your server. So this is the configuration architecture. Whenever you want to create your PostgreSQL server, you can use either the Azure CLI or Azure portal or other custom applications to create that server using the ARM. So you are using the ARM APIs, you will be creating the server. And from your application, whether it is Django or Java application or PHP application or .NET application, you will be able to connect to this PostgreSQL database using the Postgres client. This is the client library used in the application. You can also use the traditional database tools like a PG admin or PSQL kind of tools to connect to the database server. So we will see how that can be created. So if you want to use the Azure CLI for creating the server, we can log in to the Azure subscription, create a resource group, and then we can specify the database creation, means server creation command. That is, we will create a server here. As you can see, AZ Postgres server create. So we are creating the server, and the name of the server, resource group, location, then the admin username and the password, and the SKU. SKU means, I told you that SKU represents the compute and storage capacity. So this is general purpose generation 4.2. That is the SKU name. So if you go to the PostgreSQL's creation means configuration page, you will see the different pricing tiers, like the SKU values. I'll show you that in some time. Once the server is created, it is by default protected with a firewall. That means from outside Azure, you cannot directly connect to that database. It is by default restricted. So if you want to connect to your database from external server or external machines, you have to enable a firewall configuration or firewall rule to allow this connection from outside. So as you can see here, AZ Postgres server firewall rule create. So this is creating a new firewall rule that allows the IPs. You can see the name of the configuration is allow all IPs, and the starting IP range and the end IP range you can see. So it will allow your external machines to connect to that server. As you can see here, we'll simply do this demo. Let's go and complete that in 5 minutes, and then we'll take a small break. You can go to the Azure portal. Let's go to the create a resource, and in the databases section, as you can see here, this is the database category where you can see the MariaDB, MySQL, and PostgreSQL. You can choose the PostgreSQL, and you can select the single server option. So I'm going with the single server. Select a resource group, the same resource group I'm selecting. Server name, here you can specify the PostgreSQL server name as PyDay PostgreSQL. Okay, this is a valid name. Data source is none, means it's creating a new server. Location is US, that's fine. You can see the version is 11 is available, 10 is available, 9.5 and 9.6. So I can go with the 10, that's fine. Compute and storage, that is representing the SKU value. SKU value, I can click and modify if you want. If you see basic, general purpose, and memory optimized. If you see, this is the host for 1 month. If you want, you can go with the 2-core, which is decreasing the price here, you can see. And storage is 100 GB, that's fine. Okay. Below, you have to specify the administrator username and password. The default user Postgres is not available, so you have to create your own user. So lab user, and the password. Provide the username and password. Click on next. And you can see there is no additional configuration required. Just review and create. The same thing can be done using the CLI also. So for CLI, you need these two commands. Password. So this can be used to create the server, and for updating the firewall rule, you can use this. So this two commands can be used for updating, for creating the resource and updating the firewall rule. So this will be allowing the public access. So you can specify the IP range. So here I'm providing all the IPs. So the public IP access is allowed now. So here I'm not creating using command, but I have shared the command to create this. The parameters names you can modify according to your configuration. So in my case, you can see here the Postgres server is created. If you look at the connection security, you will see the firewall rule here. Allow access to the Azure services. You can give yes. Also, you can give a add the current machine's IP or add the complete IP ranges. So I'm clicking on this. So this will be adding all the IP ranges. So from any machine, I can connect to this server. Just to save the changes. So using portal, if you are doing, you can enable that in the connection security. Under this connection security, you can add this IP ranges that's done here and allow other Azure services to connect. That is done. The estimated cost it's for monthly, and that will be deducted from your free account's credit. So free account $200 is there. So if you are doing it for, if you are keeping it for 2 days, so what is the total cost for 2 days? Only that will be deducted. Validation failed. Please go to the basic page, means the first page, maybe some of the value is missing or you have given some invalid characters or something. So please provide a valid information. Partha, could I set my own IP address to access the server? Your own IP address? Yes, your machine's IP address. You can directly come here and you can see when you click on this, add current client IP address. It means this is your machine's IP. If you are not behind a proxy server, so this is your machine's IP. If you click on this, this also will be added here. So this is for allowing the current machine only. So you can start IP and end IP same because the current machine's IP. And this is for the complete range of IPs. Because this is for a demo purpose, I'm providing all the IPs. And if you go to the overview, you can see the server name and the username. Username is, what is the username you have provided there? @ the server name. Okay. So let me show you how to connect this using pgAdmin. So open the pgAdmin tool. So this is my pgAdmin interface. So let me connect to a server where I can specify the name as my PyDay server. In the connection tab, I can paste the host name and the address that I can get it from this. This is the server name. Let's copy this, put it here. Database is Postgres. Username is also available here. Copy this username and password. Okay, you can see here I have connected to that server where you can see few built-in databases, and I'm able to create my own database just by right click and create a new database. So I'm just creating a demo DB. So this is my database. Fine. Instead of pgadmin, you will be able to use any other IDE tool. It's not mandatory that you have to use pgadmin. Since Postgres is installed in my machine, pgadmin is available. You can use any other IDE tool what is available for connecting to the Postgres, use that one. Okay, so guys, you can create, while creating, you can choose the general purpose pricing tier. Even though it is showing 10,000, 15,000, don't worry, it will not deduct from your credit card or debit card. It will not deduct. If it is a free account, that will be deducted from the free account. And also, if you are using it for only 1 day or 2 day, means after today you can delete it, so it will be deducting maximum 50 rupees or 100 rupees from your account. So that you don't worry, just use it for 1 day and delete it. So only less amount will be, maybe 100 or 200 maximum will be deducted in for a day. So that you can use general purpose. If you want to go with the basic, you can go with basic also, no issue. If you have created your Azure subscription using free trial, means 1 month free trial, nothing will be deducted from your credit card or debit card. Don't worry about that. But if you have selected pay-as-you-go model, then that will be coming in the monthly bill. So guys, you have completed. So I just demonstrated how to create the Postgres server. So we have created a server and then connected using the pgadmin tool. If you are interested, I think you can use ADSQL. I think PostgreSQL can be connected through this. This is an open source free tool which can be, you can download the portable version. So the portable version can be used to connect to Postgres because it supports multiple database support. I have just click a new connection. instead of MySQL, you have to select PostgreSQL. I think this is server name, this one, username, this one, password, yeah, you can see it's connected. It is coming the database. I don't know where is the database. I need to modify the connection. Okay, here we have to select the database. Okay. Connect to Postgres. It is directly connecting to a database only. Okay, but this ID is not that good. But it's fine. Okay, so I hope you have created the Postgres database. Now we will take a small break of 10-15 minutes and then we will continue. So now it's 12 o'clock. We will take a 15 minutes break. 12:15 we will be continuing and we will continue with the next topic or next service. So let's go for a break. Don't leave the session. Stay tuned and we will continue after this. So guys, we will be continuing at 12:15. So let's go for a 15 minutes break. Hello. Hello. Can we start the session?
Yes.
Fine. So we have already discussed two Azure services for our application. One is the storage account service to keep our static files, but how to use that service in our application we'll discuss in the Django session. And the second one is database, PostgreSQL database service in the Azure platform. And now the third one we are discussing is containerization of application. So if you look, the trend now in the industry is to develop applications as containerized applications, whether it is a microservices application or it is a monolithic application. We always containerize the applications and deploy those applications in the cloud or on-premise environment. So why the containerization is so important? Because as you can see here, if I want to isolate our applications from the other applications, we previously used the virtual machines. Suppose if we have two incompatible runtimes or two incompatible applications, I want to run within a single host machine. Usually what we do, we create different virtual machines. So first virtual machine is used for running the first application, and the second virtual machine we use to run the second application. So this will give a better isolation for your application because the applications are running in two different virtual machines. But if you consider the resource utilization and the time required for setting up this virtual machine, it is too long and too difficult. Because for creating a virtual machine, you need to install a hypervisor inside your host machine. Suppose your host machine is Windows, you have to install the VMware or Hyper-V or VirtualBox. Then we will create the virtual machine. You need to install the operating system inside the virtual machine. It may be a Windows or Linux or any other edition of your operating system. Whatever version you want, you can install. So you will be installing a complete operating system, and then you will install the frameworks and the libraries and other dependencies. Then you will deploy your application. That means ultimately you are creating a new server itself, right? This will take more time because we have to install and configure everything one by one. Second thing, this is consuming more resources because consider that we have to run a simple application that is just a 10 MB or 50 MB application. Because I want to run this in an isolated environment, I have created a virtual machine. So you know that while creating a virtual machine in VMware or Hyper-V, we have to allocate CPU, RAM, disk storages, and other network resources, right? So obviously that is consuming more resources. For example, if I want to use my virtual machine's operating system as Windows Server or Linux Ubuntu, I have to allocate minimum 4 GB or 8 GB for the virtual machine itself and a 2 CPU core, and then I have to install the operating system and other resources. But what I am planning to run is just a 50 MB application. Look at that, for running a 50 MB application, I have created a complete server itself. Right? Actually, for running that 50 MB application, I don't need that 4 GB RAM or 8 GB RAM and 2 CPU and 100 GB or 50 GB storage, right? So that means the optimal utilization of resource is not happening in case of virtual machine. But if you go with the containerization technologies like Docker, RKT, LXD, LXE, these are containerization technologies. So containerization is primarily introduced in Linux. So if you go with the containerization technology, you don't need to create any virtual machines. You don't need to install any hypervisors. You containerize the application, means you whatever dependencies are required for running the application. It may be the framework, libraries, or other files, or maybe a database, or the operating system kernel. So whatever files and libraries or frameworks required for running the application, we put everything inside one box. So that logical box I can call as a container. So by containerizing the application, it is now very easy to deploy your applications anywhere, because wherever the container support is there, you can run your container there. You can run your application there. You don't need to worry about installing and configuring the frameworks in a operating system, because we don't need to create virtual machines. We don't need to allocate hardware resources explicitly. We don't need to install the operating system and the frameworks and configure the network. Nothing is required. Whatever is the application requirement, whether it is library, packages, database files, or the operating system files, anything, everything can be put together inside a box. That box is called the container. And you can run that container in all the supported platforms. It may be a cloud, it may be an on-premise, or it may be any other environment. And containers can be created in Windows, Linux, and Mac, and you can deploy that in a Linux server or in a Windows server. Depends on the type of the container. If it is Linux container, you can deploy that in Linux. If it is Windows container, you can deploy that in a Windows server. The benefit of running it as a container, because containers are very lightweight, because it contains only the operating system kernel, or maybe the agent service, means operating system agent, and the files and folders required for the application. There is no additional applications or requirements inside the container. Since it is very small in size, it can be launched very quickly. Like a virtual machine, it takes more time to create and run, but containers, we can easily start. So using the container services, we can quickly start your application in the containerized platform. So as a developer, you create the containerized application as an image. So we use mostly the Docker as the container technology. There are many container technologies available, but Docker is one of the most popular container technology. So here also we are discussing about the Docker. So the Docker can be installed in your development machine. You can create a Docker file which contains the step-by-step instructions for creating a containerized application, means how to containerize the application. The step-by-step instructions you will be writing inside the Docker file. And then you will build the image. Image means it is a blueprint for your containerized application. So you will be containerizing the application and generating the image. So that image you can store anywhere. So you will be storing the image first in your local machine, because as a developer, when you build the containerized application, that means the containerized application is called the image. So when you build the image, it is first stored inside your local repository. But if you want to deploy this application into a different production server, It may be in cloud or maybe in on-premise, but anywhere. If you want to deploy that in a different server, you have to move that image from your developer machine to production server. It is not possible to directly copy and paste the files as it is, because the container image is not a single file. It is a set of file system layers. So you cannot extract it, or you cannot copy it like a normal text file or image file. What you need to do, you have to use a publicly accessible repository like a GitHub. GitHub is a repository which can be used for uploading your code, and from anywhere you can access that code, right? So the GitHub is a repository for code management. Similar way, for managing the container images, Docker container images, we can use repositories. That is called a container repository. So one example of a container repository is Docker Hub. Docker Hub is a public repository by default, because it provides private repositories as well. But Docker Hub is by default a public repository. That means if you develop a containerized application, means an image, you can upload that image into the Docker Hub. The only thing, you must have an account there. So you can upload your Docker image into the Docker Hub. But since it is a public repository, others will be able to access those images. So they can download and use that images because it's a public repository. But in organizations, it is not be a best practice, because we will be developing our application for our customers, for clients. So the application that we are developing cannot be published as a public image, because we are developing the application only for a certain customer. So we have to deploy that in only specific servers, which should not be publicly available. Correct. So such cases, instead of using the public repositories like a Docker Hub, we will be using private repositories provided by different cloud vendors like Azure. Azure is providing a cloud repository for managing the images. It can be Windows image or Linux image. That is, that service name is called ACR, that is Azure Container Registry. Like Azure, other cloud vendors also providing such services like ECR, Elastic Container Registry from the AWS. Okay. So every cloud vendor will be providing such kind of service. So here in Azure, we have the ACR, which is a private registry. So from the development machine, we can upload the image, means the containerized application, into the ACR, that is private registry. Then I can deploy that containerized application into any Azure service, maybe a web app or a Kubernetes service or a service fabric or anywhere. You can deploy it into any Azure service. So how to do that? That is what we are going to look here. So we are not going to look the Docker technology here, because that is not our focus area. I hope you are familiar with the Docker concept. So if you have the Docker knowledge, you can easily understand what is mean by this Docker file. So I told you, if you plan to containerize your application, suppose this is a Docker file for our Django application. As you can see, it contains a set of commands which is given in the caps. So when I plan to run my Django application as a container, as a Dockerized application, I will be running my application on top of a Python image. So we can see from Python 3.7. It means I am taking the Python 3.7 image where this image already configured with the Python. So already the Python is installed and it is ready for use. So I will take the Python image and then run some additional commands to install some additional tools. As you can see, the run command, which is executing some additional commands. As you can see, apt get update, then apt get install, minus y, no install recommends, PostgreSQL client, because we are going to use PostgreSQL. So we need to have some PostgreSQL client libraries in that particular Python image. So we are executing some set of Linux command, because mostly the Python image is based on a Linux image or Linux operating system. So we are executing some Linux commands to prepare that image for running the Django application. And then you can see the work directory is used for setting up the working directory of our application. It is /user/src/app. So the /app is our working directory. And then I'll be copying the requirements.txt file to that directory. So you can see from the local machine, I'll be copying the requirement.txt file, which is a Django file, which contains the list of dependencies. So inside the txt file, it contains a list of Python dependencies, which is required in the production server. So first I will copy all the dependencies and then install that dependencies first. You can see run pip command. So I'm just running the pip command to install all the dependencies from the requirements.txt file. After that, I'm copying all the other files. So first I will complete the dependency installation and then I will copy all the remaining files. So copy dot space dot. It means all the other files will be copied into the app directory. And then I'm exposing the port number 80, because once I run the application inside a container, from outside the container, from outside the container network, if I want to connect to that application, I need to expose that port number. As you can see, I'm exposing the port number 80. And finally, the CMD is used for executing the Python server. You can see the Python application I'm running using the Python manage.py run server command. And additionally, I'm giving an argument to run the application on the port number 80. So on port number 80, it is going to run my application. Okay. So this is the Docker file, which is used for building the containerized image. So suppose if I am ready with my development machine for containerization, assume that I'm assuming that we are ready with the Docker installed in the development machine. We have the Docker file ready. We have the application ready for containerizing. And then we have to containerize the application and push that containerized image into a repository, because it is not possible to copy paste in a pen drive, right? So we have to upload this images into a repository which is publicly accessible. It can be a public repository or private repository. Public repository means with anonymous access allowed. Private repository means anonymous access not allowed. So here the ACR is a Azure service which is used for storing and managing the container images. So if you have a Dockerized application image, you can store that inside your ACR. Okay. So inside the ACR, you will be able to upload those images. And those images can be deployed into various Azure services. It means from other Azure services, you can directly access those images. As you can see, the app service or batch or service fabric or Kubernetes service, all these are supporting the container deployment. So you can deploy your containerized application into many services directly from the ACR. For that, we need to create a container registry. For creating a container registry, we can use the CLI command. As you can see, AZ ACR create, because we are creating an ACR service, creating inside this resource group the name of the ACR and the SKU. SKU means primarily the performance and the storage capacity is mentioned. So that is, SKU is basic, standard is also available. The AZ ACR login. So we are logging to the ACR, because from my development machine, I want to upload that images to the ACR. Then only it is available for deployment. So if I want to upload the image into the ACR, first I have to log in. So for that, I will use AZ ACR login minus minus name and the name of the ACR that we have created here. And if you want, you can list all the existing images. Means, is there any images already exist there? You can list those images here in a table format. And you can also list the tags with a particular repository type. You can see repository is equal to ACI hyphen hello world. So the hello world image will be displayed. And it is very important to enable the admin account, because from other services, if you want to access the images, you should enable the admin account. So there is an admin account available for ACR. By default, it is disabled. You have to enable the admin account. Then only the other services will be able to connect to that and retrieve the images. For enabling the admin user, we can use the command AZ ACR update, name of the repository, and the parameter admin enabled true. So let's first, I will show you a simple demo. So guys, if you interested, you can also go and download or create a simple Django application. Either you can create a new Django application, or you can download the already uploaded one. I have already created and uploaded a Django application. So you can go to my GitHub account. This is my GitHub account, where you will be able to see the Azure PyDay Django web. So I'm sharing this URL with you. You can clone this or download this as a zip file into your machine. Or if you are interested, you can start creating a new application. It's up to you. So this application is an already configured application. I have already configured all the parameters, everything inside it. But yes, if you want to try out the containerization, you can download this application. I have this application available here. This is the application. It's a very simple application. So I have already created a virtual environment. But before running this application, so if you want to use this application, first what you need to do, you have to create a virtual environment. For that, you can run the command. Minus mvenv test. So this will be creating a virtual environment. I have already created it, so I'm not doing that. It's already created for me. So after you open the project in Visual Studio Code, open the terminal and then just run the command like a Python, or just a simple py is enough. Minus mvenv and then
the name of the virtual revolver. Let me share this command in the chat window.
Hello. So you can create a virtual environment by running this command py minus m venv and env. So this will be creating a virtual environment like this. For this demo, you can use Visual Studio Code. This is the Visual Studio Code IDE. And you open the terminal, and the Python must be installed in your machine. So make sure the Python 3.6 or 3.7 or 3.8 version must be installed in your machine. So once this command is run, you will be able to create the virtual environment, and then you can run another command, pip install minus r requirements.txt. So this is used for restoring all the packages that is used inside of my application. So you can, this is the requirements.txt file which contains the list of packages that is used. So we can run this command to install all the packages required for your application. This may take some time. Okay, so but before that, one thing which I forgot to tell. So after the virtual environment is created, do not run that install command directly. What you need to do, first you need to switch to the virtual environment. For that, in Visual Studio Code, you can use Control Shift and P, so which will give you an option for Python select interpreter. So select that, and you will be able to see an option here. The virtual environment is available here, so env. So when you select this, you are now activated the virtual environment. You can see here, right? Once it is done, that virtual environment is selected, then you open the terminal. Means from the terminal menu, you can open the terminal. So now you can see that you are inside the environment, that is virtual environment. After that only you run this command, that is pip install command. So the pip install command you install only after enabling the virtual environment. So for that, in Visual Studio Code, press the Control Shift and P. You will see the command window here. Select the interpreter, and here you will see the available interpreters. Choose the env colon venv because our environment name is env. So select that, and then here you will open the new terminal that will come into. Now to test this, means after installing that requirements, you can run this application by using the Python manage.py run server. Since I have configured a lot of environment variables, as you can see, this is a simple two-page application. I have not created much things. This is a simple two-page application. which is reading this contact's information from the Postgres database, and the images will be stored inside the static file storage location. So this is the simple application. I just created this for this demo. If you understand that this application is ready for deployment, so currently I have just created it. If you want to customize the configuration settings, you can go to this envconfig.py file, because I have already set some environment variables like for the storage account. As you can see here, this is my storage account name, storage account key, storage account domain name, the container names. Media files will go to the media container, static files will go to the static container. And for the database engine, this is the database engine name. This is my database name that you have to create in Postgres. And this is the username for the Postgres database. This is the password for the Postgres database. This is the server name of the Postgres database that I have created. So when you copied this project, you have to modify this environment variable values. Okay, because this environment variable values I have used inside my settings.py file. As you can see here, I have configured those values here for database configurations. I'm reading the environment variables. For the static files and media files, I'm using those things, right? So when you run this application, you have to use your storage account name, storage account key, then domain, then containers names. Container names you can keep as it is, not an issue. And the database configuration, which is the Postgres database that you have created. Okay. So once it is configured, like if your application is ready for deployment, we can containerize this application. So for that, the first step is to create an ACR, because I'm planning to build the image and upload into the ACR. So for that, first I need to create ACR, that is container registry. So I told you that for creating the ACR, I can use this command. Here I will be able to use my resource group name. As well as the name of the ACR. Suppose I am going to use 5-day ACR, something like that. So this ACR, so when you use a different ACR name, you have to specify. So just go and execute this. I'm sharing that command here. So this command you can execute in the Cloud Shell or in your local machine. Once it is done, I can log into this ACR, like a AZ is great. Log into ACR. For that AZ ACR login, minus minus name, then the name of the ACR. This command will help you to connect to the newly created ACR, and you will be getting the login succeeded message. As you see, suppose if I'm planning to create this, just go and execute this in my command here. I think the resource group, it is already created. Yes, you can see it is created the ACR. Now I need to log in. So ACR login minus minus name 5-day ACR. You can see here the Docker is not running in my machine. That's why it is giving the error. Let me go and start the Docker. You can see here the Docker service is starting. Oh, not enough memory. I need to stop some of the services. Okay, so I think Docker is started now. Let me try to log in again. ACR login. By day ACR. You can see it is successfully logged in because from the Azure. Using the AZ command, I have already logged in. Previously, I have already logged in. That's why it is directly allowing me to connect to the ACR. Now, I can go and containerize my application. So this, the application is here. So this application already comes with a Docker file. So you can see a Docker file that I have created here. So using this Docker file, I can containerize my application. So to containerize and push that image, I need to go and run the Docker build command. Okay. So once you have created the ACR, you can verify inside the Azure portal. Here. Let me go to the resource group, the Pi Day workshop group. You can see here the Pi Day ACR is created here. And you can see there is no repositories. No repositories means no images uploaded till now. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to upload an image using my local machine. From my local machine, I'm going to upload using the Docker command. So when you go to the container registry service, inside the access keys section, you will see the registry name, login server name, and the admin user option, right? You can enable this admin option. So because admin option need to be enabled if you want to connect from other services. So you have to enable this admin user now. So this will create a user and a password, right? So once you have enabled this admin user, you can copy this login server name, because from the local machine, if you want to upload an image, containerized application image, the image name must be prefixed with the login server name. For example, if I want to containerize my application, I need to use Docker build command and minus T, that is a Docker tag name. Then I can specify the ACR server name slash the image name, Django app, something like that, colon latest or something. So this dot is the location of the Docker file. So here you can see the registry name is here. You can see this is the registry name, then the image name. So this is the complete tag name for your image. So whenever you upload an image, it should be in this format. So let me copy this and execute here. My Docker image Docker file is in the project folder. So this is inside the Django folder. So let me go to that folder first. CD desktop slash Python slash Django. Look at, you can see the Docker file here. Now I can go and run this command. This is creating a Docker image locally. In my machine, it is creating the Docker image. I'm sharing that command in the chat window. So the Docker build command is used for building the Dockerized image.
Yeah, Do you share the requirements data text and other files as well? The Python file.
Sorry?
Could you share the requirements.txt and other files as well?
This files?
Yeah.
So I told you this you can download from my GitHub account. So I have already shared this URL. It's already here.
Okay.
So the link I will share once again.
I think the procedure it is already mentioned what we are doing here in the GitHub link that you shared. Please clarify. Thank you.
Yeah, here it is already given the steps. I have readme file.
Yeah, I've seen that. So yeah, okay.
You can follow the steps, but since everything is configured, you just need to create a virtual environment and just go and install the requirement.txt file. Okay, so let me check. Yes, you can see the Docker image creation is completed. If I check it, Docker images listing, you can see here, this is my Docker image, the newly created Docker image, just created. Now I have to push this image to the ACR. So I can use the Docker push command to push this image to the ACR. Copy this and put it here.
Total, how much size they are? I mean, they are into GBs?
No, it's a shared file. The total image size is not exactly 1 GB. Not because the Python as well as the runtime, everything that is less than 1 GB only. It's not exactly 1.
So the as per my understanding, the link that we are going to clone here in our machine should contain all these files, right? That's why I asked.
Yeah, this that contains all the files except this virtual environment. So
okay.
Environment, you
the environment. Okay, the environment we need to create.
Yes.
So as per to rephrase once again, first we need to clone the code or the thing in our machine.
Yeah.
In a particular directory and then create the environment, and in the command prompt whatever the command you are giving that we need to provide in just the scenario. Okay.
Yeah, if you are going through Visual Studio Code, then after creating the virtual environment, you can go to the virtual environment. You can activate the virtual environment. Don't directly run the pip install command. You first activate the virtual environment.
Yeah, that I understood.
And install the pip command, and then if you have the other services ready, you can update this values accordingly, like the previously if you created storage account, then update those values. If you have created the Postgres database, update those values.
And procedure is already given under the GitHub link.
That completely not there, but because it's I didn't get time to completely document everything. That will be updated soon. So today or tomorrow, that complete documentation will be there.
Okay,
but,
fine.
Yeah, but here you just need to update those variables here. Environment variables. That's it.
Since we are not, you know, we need to wait for the video just for everybody understanding, because we need to get agreement from the Microsoft. As orchestrator told us, then we need to do the hands-on while we are going through all these exercises.
Yeah, so I don't know when this video will be released, but that you can check with the coordinator.
Yep.
So as you can see, the image push operation is almost completed. So as you can see here, the image is uploaded. If I go back to my ACR and look at the repositories now, you will see that image is uploaded here. So this image I can deploy using my web app or Kubernetes or any other service. So what we have done, using the Docker commands, we have created the image and then pushed that image to the ACR. For that, first we have created the ACR. The command I will show you once again. So this is the command for creating the ACR and logging it, logging to this. And then I have built the image, as you can see here. This is the command for building the image. After building this image, I have pushed this image. For this, I have used the Docker push command. Yeah. So look at the steps. I have first built the image locally, and then I have pushed it manually. But the ACR is providing one more option, that is direct push and build in the cloud. So as you can see in the image, it is possible that you can directly run the ACR build command, which push the code or which will upload the code into the cloud and then build the image and then store the image into the ACR. So that means you don't need to run two commands for building and pushing. So here you can see, first I build the image locally and then I push the image. So that means two commands I have executed separately, one for building the image locally, another one is for pushing. But if I go with the ACR's AZACR build command, it will help me to push the code directly to the cloud and build and store the image directly from the cloud itself. So that means locally you don't need to build anything. So you can use the AZACR build command, and here you can specify the image name like this. And then registry name, this is your registry name. And your application's location. So where is the application allocated? So that path you can specify here. That means usually the Docker file, where the Docker file is located, that path you can specify. So if you run this command, it will upload the code completely to the cloud, build from there and push it. So no need to build locally and then manually push. So these two steps we can combine using into this one. Okay, there's a cloud build process that will build the image directly from the cloud and push it. You can see if there is a build agent. So you are uploading your code into the cloud. So cloud will build the image using an agent and then push it to the container registry. So that's it, the ACR. So we will be using this image later in the coming demo. So in the post lunch, we will be starting with the deployment process, like how to use web app for deploying this Django application. So that will be discussed in the coming session, and in the second half. And we will also discuss how we can enable CI/CD for our web application. So now we can go for the lunch break. It's 1:10 now. We'll take a small... okay, I will copy and paste the commands here. The complete ACR commands, I'm pushing it here. I'm putting it here. So now we will take a break at 2:00. We will be continuing with the web application, how to deploy the code directly, and how to deploy the containerized application. Means even Docker containerization, means containerized application deployment, as well as the direct code deployment. Both we will look, and also we will see the monitoring, how to enable application insights inside the Python application, and then finally the DevOps for CI/CD. So now we can take a break. So we'll join back at 2:00. Please don't leave the session. If you leave the session, then it may not be able to join back. In case if any difficulty in joining back, then you will not be able to learn the session. So better, please stay tuned with this session. Do not leave. So thanks, everyone. We'll take a break now. At 2:00, we will be continuing.